Blackstone Publishing presents The Joyful Vegan, How to Stay Vegan in a World That Wants You to Eat Meat, Dairy, and Eggs by Colleen Patrick-Goudreau. This book is read by Colleen Patrick-Goudreau. To David, you are my heart, my soul, and my rock. You inspire me to be a better person every day and beautifully model what it means to be a joyful vegan. Introduction. The making of a joyful vegan. My doctrine is this, that if we see cruelty or wrong that we have the power to stop and do nothing, we make ourselves sharers in the guilt. Anna Sewell, Black Beauty. I was raised in a typical American family eating typical American fare, pretty much anything that came from an animal who had once walked, swum, or flown. Nightly dinners in our Irish-American home consisted of a rotation of pork chops, lamb stew, meatloaf, veal cutlets, and ground beef, along with some token vegetables on the side, always slathered with butter or submerged in cream-based sauces. With a father who owned ice cream shops and who kept a separate freezer just to store the gallons of frozen treats he brought home, I enjoyed dairy-rich desserts on a daily basis. We had a milkshake machine, a hot chocolate maker, and more candy than Willy Wonka would know what to do with. There was no dearth of animal products in our home, and I ate them all with fervor. I was also a typical child in that I cared about animals. I'm reluctant to say I loved animals because I don't believe you have to love animals to not want to hurt them. But I did and do adore animals. I've always loved being around them. I've never had a fear of them. And I shed tears at the slightest hint of them suffering at all, in real life or in books, television shows, or movies. When I was 8 years old, a bird with an injured wing fell from a tree in our yard, so I built a little house for her until she was well enough to fly again. When stray dogs made their way to our doorstep, I brought them in until I could return them to their homes. When my mother took me to see Benji, a film about a homeless dog who endures hunger, abuse, and loneliness before endearing himself to a human family, she had to drag me out of the theater mid-film for all of my weeping and wailing. I remember the day we adopted our own dog, Charmaine, an adorable, tiny, gray schnauzer with floppy ears and a loud, persistent bark. She whimpered incessantly the first few nights she was with us, which tormented me greatly. This in turn tormented my mother, who would find me in tears at her bedside in the middle of the night, begging to let our puppy come to bed with me so I could soothe her to sleep. My mother relented, and we all enjoyed restful nights thereafter. The emotional attachment I had to that little dog and her to me was gravely underestimated by my parents a few years later when, during a painful divorce and custody battle, she was taken from me with no warning. I was able to see her periodically, and eventually as a young adult, I was able to arrange to have her live with me again. But the memory of the loss of that daily bond still stings. My empathy for animals has always run quite deep, but I don't think my affection for them was very different from that of most children. Parents, teachers, and adults in general foster a connection between children and animals from the time we're born, evidenced by everything from the clothes they dress us in and the books they read to us, to the movies they screen for us and the songs they teach us. Most of us had images of baby animals adorning our childhood clothing, wallpaper, and bedding. Animal cutouts hung over our cribs in a musical mobile, and plush animals that served as our constant companions. As children, we're taught songs about animals and play games where we imitate animals. We're brought to the zoo to admire animals, and on Halloween, many of us dress up as our favorite animal. Many of us still do as adults. More than that, the adults around us use animals, albeit fictional ones, to teach us our most fundamental skills, how to count, how to spell, how to read, and how to talk. Through allegories and fables, both ancient and modern, animals even help shape our mental character by teaching us social mores, proper manners, and moral conduct. A methodical tortoise taught me that slow and steady wins the race. A panicked chicken taught me not to jump to conclusions, even if the sky appears to be falling. And three bears, a mama, a papa, and a baby, highlighted just how annoying little girls can be and how rude it is to intrude upon animals in their homes. At least, that was my takeaway. I may have missed the point on that one. Many stories we read as children are written expressly for the purpose of raising awareness about the plight and welfare of animals, including such classics as Bambi, Black Beauty, and Charlotte's Web. And often, it's a large-hearted child who becomes the champion for the imperiled animal, reflecting back to our impressionable minds a model for human-animal relations. Although the Disney-fied adaptations tend to dilute some of the poignancy of the original texts, the films still leave deep impressions on many of us. Who among us remained unmoved when Bambi learns his mother was killed by hunters, or when Dumbo's mother strains to rock her baby through the bars that imprison her, or when Black Beauty is passed from one cruel owner to the next? Charlotte's Web is the reason many children stop eating pigs, and despite its 60-plus years, it continues to inspire many to become vegetarian, or to at least take a step toward that end. Jack London's Call of the Wild, about a dog stolen from his home to be sold into service as a sled dog, still leaves an indelible impression upon students who read it in school. And Winnie the Pooh, along with his legion of furry pals, remains a link to the best parts of our childhood, when life was simple and our best friends were talking animals. Granted, I'm speaking of characters in fiction and film, but the relationships, or lack thereof, we have with animals as children in many ways shape who we become as adults, as human beings. More than that, they reflect who we are as humans. How children relate to animals is often used as a barometer for determining mental or emotional health. We know that if a child is kind to an animal, it's a good sign. It demonstrates that the child is capable of tenderness, compassion, attachment, and empathy. On the other hand, if a child abuses or hurts an animal, it's considered a red flag. The National School Safety Council, the U.S. Department of Education, the American Psychological Association, and the National Crime Prevention Council all agree that animal cruelty is a strong predictor of potential violence against humans. In other words, the research bears out what we know instinctively and anecdotally, that the more children are encouraged to bond with animals, the more they experience empathy and exhibit compassion for everyone, humans and non-humans alike. My parents, teachers, and other adults in my life didn't necessarily know about this research, yet in practically every aspect of my life, I was encouraged to have a relationship with animals and was given the message that non-human animals were integral to who I was and helping to shape who I was becoming. What I didn't know was that, at the same time, I was being fed the dismembered bodies of animals. Animals no different from the ones I was brought to the zoo to pet or whose wings I...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.